Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 12.1.1 to the public. If you're on iOS 12 or newer, you'll be able to update to this version. It's available now around the whole world. Now, this came in at 2.77 gigabytes on my iPhone XS Max, and it will be large like that if you're currently on a beta. Now, if you are not on a beta, it will be a little bit smaller, so it'll come in somewhere around this 418.1 megabytes on my iPhone 8 Plus, and if you are on the beta, you'll need to uninstall the beta profile. You do that by going to Settings, General, scroll down, you'll have the beta profile, tap on it, delete it, reboot your phone, then check for the software update and you'll be able to update. It's pretty simple and straightforward, but you'll need to do that first. Now let's take a look at the build number. So we'll go into Settings, go back to General, and then About, you'll see the build is 16C50. And this particular build brings quite a few features and improvements, but let's first talk about storage. Now, I checked my storage before doing the update. I was using 38.8 gigabytes of storage on my XS Max, and system was taking up 20.33 gigabytes. After installing this, let's take a look. We'll go to iPhone storage, and it's using a little bit more storage, 42.8 gigabytes. Let's check system. System is using less at 18.12 gigabytes. So you gain a little bit, but you lose a little bit elsewhere. So the first feature has to do with the iPhone XR specifically, and that has to do with notifications. If we pull down, we can now use the peek and pop where it opens up and we can swipe them off and everything else like before, but that feature is now available. It's not available on the home screen as far as haptic feedback or haptic touch, but that's probably coming later on. Now the next thing has to do with dual SIM support. So if you have a phone that supports dual SIMs like the iPhone XR and you go into settings and then you go to cellular, you'll have the ability to add a cellular plan, and this supports more carriers now. So you can add a cellular plan, scan a QR code, enter details manually, and you'll be good to go if you need to use an extra SIM card or an eSIM. Now the next thing is on the iPad. The iPad in the news app specifically now supports hiding the sidebar. So I don't really use this app too much, but in this particular version, you can hide the sidebar. You couldn't hide it before, it was always present. So in landscape specifically. Now the next thing has to do with FaceTime. They've redesigned it and it's so much better. Let's take a look at that. I'll make a FaceTime call and show you what I mean. So on the left, I have an iPhone XS. On the right is a XS Max on the latest 12.1.1 version. So this is the older one, this is the newer one, and you'll see we have the ability to flip the camera right away. We can flip this around and it's much easier to get to. We can mute, go to effects, and if we slide up, then we can turn the camera off or go to the speaker. Here we had to hit the three dots, and then we have similar features, but it just wasn't as convenient. And then also you can take a photo. Now this has to be turned on both, and both people must agree to it, and it needs to be on the latest version to do that. So both people need to be on 12.1.1, then you can snap a photo of whatever you're seeing on your display. So that's a nice update, and finally they've brought that back. Now, when it comes to iPads and iPod Touch with Wi-Fi calling, it now has real-time text. And then also, if you're sharing a photo, so if we go back into that storage and maybe I want to share this photo, the actual icons down here for the Apple Watch have been updated as well. So that Apple Watch face is updated to the Series 4. So it just looks a little bit more current. And then also there's something new under the Health app. So let's take a look at that. So within the Health app, you'll see if we go to Heart and then scroll down, we'll go to ECG, which is now here, and you have ECG data. So if you have an Apple Watch Series 4, once they update this, you'll be able to use this for echocardiogram. And the feature's not there yet, so I thought it was going to come out today, but it looks like it didn't. Apple did push a bunch of updates to other devices though. Now the next fix has to do with stability improvements for dictation and voiceover. So before it wasn't that great, let's try it. And dictation and voiceover should be working a lot more accurately now when you're speaking to it. So before it really messed up, and so far it seems to be keeping up pretty well. So that seems to be working a little bit better. And then there's a bunch of bug fixes. Now we will talk about battery and everything in just a moment, but first of all, the first bug fix has to do with Face ID becoming unavailable. So if you have a device with Face ID, a 10, 10S, 10R, 10S Max, Face ID should work all of the time now and shouldn't have an issue with that. Also, if you were missing your voicemails under the phone, the visual voicemails should now be fixed. Sometimes it wasn't appearing or your voicemails wouldn't appear, and that should be resolved. Also, if you're using the keyboard and you're using specifically Japanese or Chinese keyboards and you're using text messages It wasn't predicting text properly. Now it should be doing that properly. Also, if you're using voice memos, they were not uploading properly to iCloud or updating, and that should be resolved now as well. Now, there's also been stability improvements all over the place, and also issues with time zones updating should now be fixed properly. So all of those things have been fixed. They also pushed an update to HomePod that now has the LEDs illuminate when you're in a group FaceTime call. So if you do want to update your HomePod, you can go to Home, tap on the little Home in the upper left, go to Home Settings, and then go to Home, and then Software Update. It took a little bit to find that, but it's now up to date. And if you make a FaceTime call, it will make those little lights go off. Now, battery life on the previous beta was okay. It was not the greatest I've had. I've been using this quite a bit on beta 3, and it will take a few days to know how it is on this current version of iOS. But if we look over the past 10 days, this day was pretty good, 4 hours and 52 minutes. I'd say I've been getting between 4 and 5 hours of screen on time, usually with this particular version. That's not very good, but hopefully they've updated that and fixed that a little bit in this. And I'll be doing a follow-up where I go into that a little bit more in detail. Now, speed overall seems to be really good. I did check it across all of these devices, everything from scrolling to moving through different apps. If we pick up one of the older phones, the SE, or maybe the 6S Plus, all of these seem to be super smooth. I don't know if they've changed something with scrolling, but I've only had a hiccup so far on the XS Max, strangely. So it seems to be okay. We'll open an app here. There we go. The app seems to be okay. Everything seems to be working fine. If we open, say, Minecraft, we'll see. It was slow before, so Minecraft is kind of a benchmark I've been using because it was incredibly slow before. So if we just create new, move this up here, wait for it to load, and it should be pretty quick. This took a really long time in the previous beta builds, and it seems to be fixed, and it's working okay, and should be pretty playable now. So it looks like it's okay, and we should be good to go. So there's not a whole lot going on there. And then with older devices, it's going to take a few days to know how it is on all of these devices. So I have an iPhone 10 here, and I did run a Geekbench on some of these. Here's the 10 Geekbench that I ran. If we go to the Geekbench on the XS Max, you'll see these are the scores I've been getting. And if we look at the previous score, when I ran the last benchmark on November 7th, this was an older one, we're doing quite a bit better. So we are getting some higher scores now. With CPU, 4,752 for single core, 10,834 for multi-core. On the 10, we're doing pretty good as well. And I didn't have time to run them on all of them, and they all seemed super smooth that I didn't find that it needed to be addressed, really. It seems to be they've fixed all the smoothness issues. Now, as far as any other little changes, it's hard to say what they're doing, and I'm looking forward to that ECG update for the Apple Watch. So those are all the major fixes. If I find anything else, I'll be sure to do a follow-up, and I'll do a follow-up seeing what you have to say on the YouTube community poll, so be sure to check back there. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, I'll link it in the description, as I always do. If you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe and like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.